our Passion Week, one of the most important periods in the Christian calendar. The period is a sequence of 8 days that provides us Christians an opportunity to reflect on the transformation of humanity brought about by the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. This week also signifies the last week of the Lenten season, a period that many of us were carefully examining our lives, trying to make an informed decision as to what sacrifices we were going to make and what you were going to give up. But what many of you do not realize is that the mere fact that you did not give up is a major accomplishment. Let me repeat that again. The mere fact that we did not give up over the last 40 days and we are still here standing is a true testament of our faith. And I think that you should give God a praise offering for that. Our service today will be punctuated with drama, poetry, and musical pieces as we commemorate the crucifixion and death of Jesus under the theme, Worthy is the Lamb. Although Jesus made the ultimate sacrifice for us, we often speak of having our own cross to bear. Like you, I carry my cross every day. But gone are the days when I carry my cross on my shoulder. I now carry my cross in my pocket, a simple reminder to me that I am a Christian no matter where I may be. This little cross isn't magic, nor is it a good luck charm. It isn't meant to protect me from every physical harm. It's not for the identification for all the world to see. It's simply an understanding between my Savior and me. When I put my hand in my pocket to pull out a coin or a key, the cross is there to remind me of the price he paid for me. It reminds me too to be thankful for my blessings every day and to strive to serve him better in all I do or say. It is also a daily reminder of the peace and comfort I share with all who know my Master and give themselves to his care. So my challenge to you today is to make a little cross and place it in your pocket, reminding none but thee that Jesus Christ is the Lord of your life, if only you would let him be. Amen? Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, as we gather today, we remember the pain and suffering of the cross and all that Jesus was willing to endure for us so that we could be set free. He paid the price, such a great sacrifice, to offer us the gift of eternal life. Help us never to take this for granted, this huge gift of love on our behalf. Help us to be reminded of the cost of it all. Forgive us for being too busy or too distracted, and for not fully recognizing what was freely given, what was done for all of us. Today, we commemorate the death of our Savior Jesus Christ, and we ask that you will be right here in our presence, right here in our midst. Bless this service, bless the congregants, bless those online, and everyone that will be participating. And may everything that is done be done to your honor and glory. Amen and amen. Let's give God another praise offering as we invite Sister Kimberly and the worship team to lead us in worshiping song.
I think we can do better than that. Let's give God a clap offering. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to do what? Save the world through him. years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great, and grace was free. Pardon there were multiplied to me. There my burning soul for liberty found liberty at Calvary. Mercy and grace, an expression of God's love. None are deserved for our wrongdoings, the sins we commit. We serve a God who is full of compassion, who is steadfast in his love and faithful, and God who sent his son to die so that we can have eternal life. Amen.
Money.
light. And the burden of my heart did what?
Rolled
away. It was there by faith. I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. God sent his son, his only begotten son, to die on the old rugged cross so that we could have eternal life. Therefore, we must do what? We must cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. We lay down our trophies at last. We lay down. We will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Amen.
See you.
Am I that you, O Lord, the bright and morning star, Prince of Peace, my all in all, would bleed and die for me? Who am I to find favor in your merciful sight, to be called from dreadful plight, to be asked to be your child? Who am I that you would die for me? We are now going to have a special ministry called, you guessed it right, Who Am I by Niall Brunton.
Told me who I am. because of what I've done, but because of who you are. A flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. You told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours. I am yours. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? 'Cause I'm yours.
Have you ever met someone that you knew as soon as you met them that they would change your life? I felt that way when I met Jesus. You see, I had been depressed for so long. Some people thought that there were demons in me. Other people said I just had a lot of illnesses. To be honest, I didn't care what they called it. All I know is that life was awful and I was miserable. Life was nothing but torment. My sister Martha and my brother Lazarus, they did all that they could to take care of me. But I know it was stressful for the whole family. It was hard for us to have friends or to be able to be a part of the community. I was an outcast. But then I met Jesus. There is something wonderful when someone accepts you for who you are. He could see past the erratic behavior and the language and moans and streaks that would come from me. He saw deep inside me. He saw what no one else could see. He spoke one word and the demons left me. Instantly, I felt a peace. I felt a peace I had never known before. Life would never be the same. My heart belonged to Jesus from that moment on, and nothing would change that. Jesus often visited our home, and there was nothing I liked more than to sit at his feet and listen to him teach. I could hear the whispers, sometimes that I shouldn't be there. It wasn't right for a woman to be taught in the same manner that men were. But where else should I have been except at his feet, the feet that walk down dusty roads? I learned a lot from listening to him. And some of what I heard made me sad. He talked about his death, about things that would happen to him in the future. None of his disciples seemed to really pay attention to what he was saying. But I couldn't get rid of the sorrow inside me. How could I bear it if he went away or if something happened to him? I loved him. My whole life was wrapped up in his. I didn't want to be like one of the other disciples and tell him these things couldn't happen. They could happen. They would happen. How could I show him how I felt about him? Show him that I understood. I remember the perfume I had. It was the only thing of value that I owned. I could think of nothing better for my master. So one night, when he was at our home for dinner, I tucked the perfume and poured it all over his feet. His feet. The feet that walked on water. The smell of the perfume filled the room, and I loved him so much that I would have done anything for him. I let down my hair and began wiping his feet. I could hear the whispers then too, that I shouldn't have wasted the perfume, that I could have sold it and given the money to the poor. I could feel my face burn with shame. Was it wrong of me to show my love for him? But then he spoke. His word at one time had driven the demons from me. And now, his word drove away accusations. But I heard words even I didn't want to hear. My burial. I remember his words. Was I the only one who heard that? And now standing at the cross, his mother beside me, I look at the bleeding and tortured man in front of me. His arms are outstretched as though they could embrace the whole world. His feet are nail pierced. His feet, the feet that I anointed for his burial. I remember his words, but I remember other of his words as well, about death, about being raised, about promises of an afterlife. And although my heart is full of sorrow, there is life and hope within. And I think about his feet, the feet that will walk down the road again.
Romans chapter 3, verse 25 says that Jesus is our mercy seat. Because of his death on the cross, we come to him for mercy, for God has made a provision for us to be forgiven by faith in the sacred blood of Jesus. How beautiful is it to contemplate on the fact that Jesus' very blood was sprinkled on the mercy seat, the throne of grace. He is making intercession for our sins before God. His flawless sacrifice made it possible for God's presence to be in our midst. Let us welcome Julia Boyce as she renders mercy seat for us.
Thank you.
In the darkness, where everything is unknown, I face the power of sin on my own. I did not know of a place I could go, where I could find a way to heal my wounded soul. He said that I could come into his presence without fear, into the holy place where his mercy hovers near. I'm running to the mercy seat where Jesus is calling. He said his grace would cover me, his blood will flow freely, it will supply the healing. I'm running to the mercy seat. I'm running to the mercy seat. Are you living where hope has not been? You're lost in the curse of a lifetime of sin. Lovely illusions, they never come true. I know a place where there is mercy for you. He said that I could come into his presence without fear, into the holy place where his mercy hovers near. So come running to the mercy seat where Jesus is calling. He said his grace would cover you, his blood will flow freely, it will provide the healing. I'm running to the mercy seat. Come running to the mercy seat. He said that I could come into his presence without fear, into the holy place where his mercy hovers near. Come running to the mercy seat where Jesus is calling. He said his grace would cover you, his blood will flow freely, and it will supply the healing. Come running to the mercy seat. I'm running to the mercy. Come running to the mercy seat where Jesus is calling. He said his blood will cover you, his blood will flow freely, and it will supply the healing. I'm running to the mercy seat. Come running to the mercy seat. To the mercy seat.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sister Jalea. The Bible says the effectual fervent prayer availeth much. We will now invite our pastor, the Reverend Lennox Boyce, to take our petitions to the throne of God in prayer, grace in prayer.
Father, we bow in your presence today, thanking you, God, for your grace, And thanking you, God, for your mercy that has been extended to us. Thank you, Father, that in our most difficult moments, at the times, God, when we are most ashamed of ourselves, Father, at the time when we've made terrible mistakes and we wish that we could go backward in time and correct them, Father, thank you that in the times when we feel messed up and mistreated and abused and afflicted, that there is a place that we can go. Thank you, Father, that there is a throne of grace. Thank you, Father, that there is a mercy seat. And Father, because we are your people, because when Jesus died, the veil of the temple was rent in twain, it means that we all have the right and the privilege and the opportunity to come into that holy place and have our needs addressed and our petitions heard. Thank you, God, for everything that this day represents in our lives as the people of God. Thank you, Father, for embracing us. Thank you, God, for loving us. Thank you, Father, for lavishing us with your love and with your grace and with your mercy and with your forgiveness. Father, for none of us, not one of us was worthy of your love and of your forgiveness. But Father, you look past our issues. You look past our shortcomings. And Lord, you administered your love and your grace and your mercy to us. And so, Father, today we can lift our hands and we can say, praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for your grace. Thank you, Jesus, for your love and for your mercy. When we were not a people, you embraced us and made us a people. When we were children of darkness, you embraced us, God, and made us children of light. Father, when our lives were full of sin, you took our sins upon yourself and you gave us your righteousness. And now we are new creatures in Christ. All things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. And Father, even though we still have struggles, even though we still have issues, and even though from time to time we trip and we fall, Lord, we thank you that your mercies are extended to us. Father, we would not be here today had it not been for your grace and had it not been for your mercy. The predictions that the people had of us would have come true, God, had it not been for your grace and for your mercy. The designs that the enemy had on our lives would have realized had it not been for your grace and for your mercy. But Father, we thank you today. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you, God, for loving us so much that you sent your Son to die in our place. And Father, we rejoice today. We rejoice today that Jesus was the propitiation for our sins. We rejoice today that even though he came to his own and his own did not receive him, because we received him and believed on his name, he made us children of God. So we thank you today. We bless you. We pray that the meaning of this day and of this season will not be lost in the days after we have finished our celebration. But may we live like people of the cross. May we walk like people of the cross. May our lives reflect the love and the power and the passion of Jesus, so that everywhere we go, the world will be changed by Christ through us. Father, I pray that every need that is represented in your house today will be met in the power of the Spirit. I pray that every work
every deed of darkness, everything the enemy is designing for people today will be broken by the power of Jesus. I pray, dear Father, that everything that the enemy is scheming will come to naught, but that your people, God, will walk in victory. And those persons in our sphere of influence, God, I pray that the overflow of our lives will make a difference in theirs. Do it for us today. We pray in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Amen.
There were so many things I wanted to say to you, my son, and I always thought I'll have the time. And now it's nearly too late, so I'll say them now. I was so young when the angel Gabriel came to me and told me about God's blessings upon me. I was confused. I just didn't know how it could happen. And I was a little worried too, worried about Joseph and how he will handle it. It seems now that all of that for a teenager was too much to handle. I look now at the young girls in Galilee, ribbons in their hair, laughter in their voices. And I can't imagine that I was ever so carefree, ever that young. I feel so old now. When I look at you, I see the little baby you were as I held you in my arms the first time. I was so tired. Your father and I had traveled to Bethlehem on donkey for the census. It was an uncertain time, so scary, so tense. Your father tried hard not to show how nervous he was, but I could tell. And then when we finally got there, and there was no room for us anywhere, he was almost at a breaking point. I know I was. He apologized so many times as he led me into the barn. I didn't care. I just needed somewhere quiet and warm to lay down. I was in so much pain. I couldn't concentrate on anything else. That pain was nothing, though, to compare to now. When I first became pregnant, I said to your Aunt Elizabeth that all generations will call me blessed. I'm not so sure now, son. I never told anyone about the day we presented you at the temple. You've heard what the prophet Simeon said about you, that you will be a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to our people. And you have been, my son. Your kindness to the outcast has drawn people to you, and in you, people have seen the face of God. But it also drew unwanted attention to you, anger, hatred. At times, I wanted you to be a little quieter, a little more cautious around the Pharisees. You could have, you know. You didn't always have to provoke. You didn't always have to speak the truth, did you? And yet, I know that doing that, that softening your words or backing down, will make you a different man. Do I wish you were a different man? How could I want that? You are the hope of Israel, the hope of all mankind. What I never told anyone was that Simeon said that a sword will pierce my soul. At that time, I never knew what it meant. But I know now, my son, I know now. I always wanted to protect you from pain. I hated every bruise and scrape, but I couldn't protect you from pain when you were little. And I was helpless to stop any of the violence inflicted on you today. I felt the lashes that fell on your back, the back that I washed as a little boy. I screamed until my throat was raw at those who heard awful names at you, the son whose name I whispered daily in my prayers. I wept when they crushed the crown of thorns on your head, the head I kissed goodnight every time I put you to bed. But when they drove spikes through your hands, hands I held as we walked down the road, I felt the sword pierce my soul. I stand now at your cross. There are no miracles this time. The light has gone out of my life, even as it is draining from the sky. All generations will call me blessed. I'm not so sure now. I'm not so sure.
But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. The song Amazing Grace, also known as My Chains Are Gone, reflects on the transformative power of God's grace in a person's life. The verses speak of a person who was lost in sin and darkness, but through God's grace and mercy have been set free. When we accept God's grace and mercy, we are no longer bound by the weight of sin and by guilt, but instead, we are now given a new life and new hope. The psalm is a celebration of the incredible gift of God's grace and a timely reminder that no matter what, no matter how far we've strayed, that we will never, never stray too far, and we will never be gone to be too far to be saved by God's grace. Let us now welcome Shawnee Davis as she sings Amazing Grace, also known as My Chains Are Gone.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. 'Twas blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear.
Praise the Lord and good morning to everyone. I take this opportunity to say welcome to you to our Good Friday service. Come on, can we put our hands together and bless our Lord today? Amen, amen. That was an okay applause. And if that was for me, I'd be happy. But for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, I think we can dig a little bit deeper. Come on, let's bless the Lord today for his goodness and his love, for his faithfulness and his mercy. Amen. The psalmist said it is God's mercies that we are not consumed. There's a lot out there. But because of God's mercies and God's grace, amen, he watches over us. He protects us. He surrounds us. His angels stand guard around us because we are his children. Amen. So I want to welcome you to our Good Friday service. We've been having a great time together as we were exposed to music ministry and ministry of the spoken word and in drama and being exposed to the giftedness of God's people. We bless the Lord for everyone who has come so far, and we have a bit more to go. So we want you to stay with us. Those of you who are online, It is good that you chose to be with us for Good Friday. And, you know, we celebrate what indeed was a Good Friday, because it marked a time when we were released from captivity. Amen? Amen. We who were bound in sin had been set free because of God's grace. So I just pray that even as we continue in our time of commemoration and our time of celebration, that in the multitude of these experiences, that the Lord will speak to our hearts, that the Lord will change our hearts and our lives, and that something that happens here will make an indelible impression in your mind and create significant change in your heart. God bless you.
Had authority. The first news I heard of him seemed impossible. He casted out demons. He healed the sick with a touch or even just a word. He said, "Be clean," and leprosy vanished. "Rise," and the paralytic stood up and walked. I knew the scriptures from the synagogue. No one had power like that since Elisha. And his teaching were even more unbelievable. He claimed to be the Lord of the Sabbath. The Sabbath directly commanded by God through Moses. And he forgives sins. I mean, no one but God can forgive sins. If it was anyone else, I'll say they were insane. But his teaching, there was something different about his teaching. I didn't know exactly what was going on, but the more I thought about it, that word, authority, kept replaying itself in my head. Jesus had authority. And he had more authority than any other human. I began believing it. And when he brought my servant back from the edge of death, from across Capernaum, I knew it. Jesus deserved reverence. I was in Jerusalem for the Passover when he came. And what he did? Laying out palm branches. It was right. He deserved it. He deserved that welcome. But then they arrested him. They beat him. They dressed him in purple and shoved that crown of thorns on his head. They made him into the parody of a king. And they mocked him, bowing down to him and pretending that he was a king, that they were being reverent. They gave him scorn and spite. The one man who deserves a crown of gold, the crowns of all the kings on earth, wore that mockery of a crown. Instead, I don't understand it. He had the power to make that not happen. He had authority over disease and even death. Surely he had the authority to do something. Why didn't he? How could he have let this happen? Jesus had an authority I don't fully understand. I saw it, and others saw it too. He should have been put on a throne, but they nailed him to the cross instead. He deserved reverence, but he submitted to mockery and the most shameful death my people can bring. I'm here because I want to understand why.
And as they led him away, they seized one Simon, who was coming in from the country, and laid on him the cross to carry it behind Jesus. And there followed him a great multitude of people and of women who were mourning and lamenting for him. But turning to them, Jesus said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For behold, the days are coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do these things when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?" Doing a rendition called "Don't Cry for Me," Sister Naomi Williams.
That old familiar place, where the winds will blow, no one ever knows the time or place. Don't cry for me. Don't shed a tear. The time I share with you will always be. And when I'm gone, please carry on. Don't cry for was meant to be. Don't carry guilt or shame. The reason why I came, soon you'll see. Don't cry for me. Don't shed a tear. The time I share with you will always be. And when I'm gone, please carry on. Don't cry for me. Not the joy it should be. With life comes pain. Soon time will his course appointed, and you will be rewarded, and all the world would see. Don't cry for me.
Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. That is that name of Jesus, that the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 to 10. The Bible teaches us that there is a name above all other names that we know. Whatever circumstances, trials, or tribulations we're facing, they are just names which are all under one greater name, Jesus Christ. So when you're feeling down and out and in need of direction, call upon the name of Jesus and he shall set you free. Let us welcome Sister Enif King as she comes to minister that name.
Before I sing, I just want to share this scripture from Matthew 20:29. To 34. Jesus and his disciples went to Jericho, and as they were leaving, they were followed by a large crowd. A blind beggar by the name of Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, was sitting beside the road. And when he heard that it was Jesus from Nazareth, he shouted, "Jesus," I don't even think he said it like that, "Jesus, Son of David, have pity upon me." And many of the people in the crowd tried to hush him and tell him, "What are you keeping so much noise for?" But he shouted even louder, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy upon me." I want you all to shout before I begin to sing. The name that has been given that is above every other name that there is in heaven and in earth. The name Jesus. I want you to shout the name of Jesus like your life depends upon it. Jesus! Have mercy upon me, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
So precious, a name so wonderful to me. This name is worthy of all praises. Because of him, I am made free. That name is Jesus. Oh, how so
to my storm clouds. His name speaks calm into my fears, that when I feel like no one loves me, his loving presence is so near. That name is Jesus. Oh, how I love him, the one who gave his life for me because of love so unconditional.
Thank you, Sister Ine, for that marvelous rendition. And thank you to all the persons who shared with us and shared their talents with us this morning. We now invite our pastor to the podium.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Come on, let's put our hands together. Let's bless the Lord one more time. Stories told of a man who worked at a station at an intersection where a river ran under a bridge. And his only job was to pull a lever. This lever would either open the bridge or close it, pretty much like the swing bridge that you know so well works. So he would pull the lever and hold it in position one way, because when he did that, it caused the bridge to open and ships could pass. He would only release the lever when the ship had safely passed. And then he would prepare to pull it
the other way so that the bridge could close so that trains could pass over the bridge. When he didn't pull the lever one way or the other, the bridge would be half open, which meant that neither ships nor trains could pass. What a responsibility he had. And so the man did his work faithfully, pulling the lever one way so that ships could pass, and pulling the lever the other way and holding it in position so that trains could pass. He did this day in and day out. And one day, he decided that he would take his son to work with him. And so he took his son to the job. And his son was fascinated as he saw his dad doing this very important work, pulling the lever one way, and great mighty trains going over the bridge or across the bridge. And then he's seeing his dad release the lever and the bridge coming half open. And then he's seeing his dad pulling the lever the other way and holding it in place so that ships could pass through. But like most little boys, the thing that fascinated him the most was the water. He saw the river. And he was fascinated by the crystal clear water of the river. And like all little good little boys do, he looked at the river. Then he decided that he wanted to touch the river. So he ran down by the water and he put his fingers in. Then that was not enough. So he put his toes in the water. All the while, his dad is doing his important work of pulling the lever one way so that trains could go across, and pulling the lever the other way so that ships could pass through. But then the little boy got dissatisfied with just having his toes in the water. And so he began to splash in the water. And each time he did it, he would run back to his dad with excitement because he had done something that was interesting. The time came when a train was approaching with thousands of passengers. His dad realized that he didn't run back to him another time. And the train is approaching, and his dad is scanning the area for his son. And then he spotted him. But by this time, splashing was not enough. And he was way out in the water. His dad knew that he couldn't swim. He saw him struggling to get back to shore. But he had a responsibility. There were thousands of passengers on the train. And if he had decided that he would let the lever go, thousands of passengers would die. His son is drowning, but thousands of passengers' lives are at stake. And here is the dad, holding the lever tightly to keep the bridge intact so that these passengers can live, even though it had become obvious to him that his son was going to die. Can I say to us today that God held the lever in place for all of us? For all of us. For all of us. Sacrificing his son so that you could have life. So that you could have life. So that I could have life. And so the central verse in all of Scripture says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish but have everlasting life. Romans says, for scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Christ died for us. And so, having died for us, a way has been opened up that lives of any kind, people of any kind, any race, any nationality, any color, any creed, any background, any type of past can find life and hope and salvation and life in Jesus. So as we stand together today, let's stand. And as we bow our heads in this moment of reverence, we want to thank God for the cross and for its significance. Because the cross represents God holding the lever, watching his son die so that you can live. And no, we didn't deserve it, but God did it for us anyhow. And so, if you're here today and you don't know Jesus, you are here today and you've never given your life to Christ, you've never surrendered to him and said, Lord, thank you for dying for my sins. I give you my life today. Could you just raise your hand where you are? And by doing that, you're saying, I want to give my life to Jesus. I want to give my life to Jesus. And one call for those persons who hold on to everything they have, not willing to sacrifice so that others could live. But you want to say it today, Lord, I'm willing to sacrifice what I have so that others could live. You sacrifice your son for me. I didn't deserve it. And Lord, nothing that I have is too important for me, too necessary for me to cling to. Lord, I'll give it up for you. So Father, if it's a bad habit that's getting in the way, I'm gonna give it up for you. If it's a relationship that I ought to stay away from, I'm gonna give it up for you. If it's a possession that I have that I am worshiping rather than worshiping you, I'm gonna give it up for you. My gifts, my talents, my time, my treasure, none of it is so good that I can't give it to you. And so those persons who want to be sold out for Christ, could you just raise your hand today and take it back down? For all that you've done for me, God, count on me to lay it at your feet and be your servant. And be your servant. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. I'm going to pray for you today. The worship team then is going to sing. Thank you for the cross. And we want to thank God. Thank God for the cross and for the price that was paid. Heavenly Father, today, thank you for the gift of your Son, Christ Jesus. Father, thank you that when we didn't want you, you chased us down. When we didn't want to be associated with you, kept turning you away, you never gave up on us. Thank you, Lord, that when our lives were messy, you still pursued us. Your grace, your mercy, your love, your compassions, your forgiveness. We experience God in abundance as you came after us. Thank you, Lord, for not giving up when we were stubborn. Thank you for pursuing us, for pursuing us until we said yes. And I pray for everyone today who's still running. I pray they would come to the place where the burden of sin and its tiredness would cause them to look to you. And Lord, that you will lift their burden. You will give them freedom and liberty, because your word says that your yoke is easy, your burden is light. Father, may we as your people never allow things to get in the way of what we can do for you. So I pray, God, that everything that we need to sacrifice to be in right place with you, everything that we need to sacrifice to be able to walk in step with you, everything we need to sacrifice to be able to honor you and live for you, God, that we would sacrifice it, that we would give it up, so that we can be your people and do all that you have ordained for us to do. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works that God has ordained for us to walk in. May we walk in your steps, live your word, change our world. Let our light shine and make a difference everywhere we go. Thank you for the change that has been wrought in our lives because of the cross. Thank you, God, for the cross and for its significance in our lives. We bless you, God, and all God's people said, amen, amen, amen. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Worthy, worthy is the Lamb. Indeed, worthy is the Lamb. We wish to express our sincerest thanks to everyone that participated in today's Good Friday program. I hope that each and every one of you, that there's something that you would have been able to take away from the performances and the talents that was shared here today. We now wish to express our sincerest thanks to those of you online for joining us. And I too hope that you were blessed, because it is indeed a blessing when you can use your talents to bless others. Good Friday is usually a day of reflection, quiet reflection, and meditation. And we trust that there was some nugget of today's service that has found its way into your heart and can form part of that reflection as we remember all that God was willing to do for us. But just before we close our online segment of today's service, there are a few notices that we would wish to share with you. Today is Good Friday, and we will be heading over to the Garrison Savannah at 4:30 p.m. for our annual kite flying. So bring your kites and your family and come join us at the Garrison Savannah this evening at 4:30 p.m. for kite flying. Join us on Sunday morning for our resurrection celebration service at 8:30 a.m. Every Monday, our men's prayer time is held at 5:30 a.m. on Zoom. And every Wednesday, women's prayer time on Zoom at 5:30 a.m. World Changers Bible Study on Wednesday night is held every Wednesday night at 7:30. The new online series, Your Identity in Christ, will be, and is shaping up to be, a very impactful series, which will be important for the growing believer. We are asking every member of our church to join every Wednesday night for a World Changers Bible Study with our pastor, the Reverend Lennox Boyce. Church of God Day will be held this year on Sunday, April 21st at King George V Memorial Park. And our 90th anniversary service, we have approximately 5 weeks until our 90th anniversary service, and this is going to be held on Sunday, May 5th, and it is going to be held right here in our sanctuary at 4 p.m. We will be assembling a 90-voice choir for this event, which will begin our year-long anniversary celebrations. Summerfest 2024 will be held in Tobago from July 13th to 18th, and Youth Camp will run concurrently from July 13th to July 27th. Please visit Caribbean Atlantic Assembly's Facebook page to sign up. Ready, Set, Grow. Vacation Bible School is back. Join us July 15th to 26th for 2 weeks of VBS. Save the date and stay tuned for more details. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, Church of God Silver Sands, and follow us on Facebook. If you need to contact us, please email us at cogsilversands@gmail.com. On behalf of the pastor, the Reverend Lennox Boyce, our assistant pastor, Minister Patrick Bellamy, and our church council, we wish to thank you for joining us in our Good Friday service. We are blessed, and we were indeed blessed, to have you join with us, and we look forward to have you joining in our future services. Today we remembered the pain and suffering of the cross and all that Jesus was willing to endure so we could be set free. He paid the ultimate price, such a great sacrifice, to offer us the gift of eternal life. Help us never to take for granted this huge gift of love that Jesus sacrificed for us and on our behalf. Help us to be reminded of the cost of it all. Lord, your word declares that by your wounds we were healed. Thank you for that, because of your huge sacrifice we can now live free. Thank you that sin and death have been conquered and that your power is everlasting. Thank you that we can say with great hope, it is finished, for we know what's still to come and death has lost its sting. We praise you for making all things new. And as we close our online stream, may the very face of God shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God's presence embrace you and give you eternal peace. And a gentle reminder, make your cross and place it in your pocket as a reminder only to thee that Jesus can be the Lord of your life if only you will let him be. Have a blessed day. Good morning.